with some very important issues, like I said, healthcare, jobs. Ag's a big thing, you know, in Tulare County. You know, Tulare County and Fresno County go back and forth every year as a top agricultural producer in the world. So they definitely want to continue to have those jobs because they employ a lot of people. And they may give people reasonable living standards, but it gives the opportunity to the next generation to move forward like I did. So that's very important to me. Housing, dealing with a lot of different issues in housing. There's a lot of money out there with cap and trade to try to better the air quality, try to deal with a lot of other environmental issues. There's housing money out there. I'm very big. I sit on a task force in Tulare County that deals with homelessness, so that's a big issue for me to try to tackle that. You know, I mean, I don't really, coming from LA where, you know, you have 30, 40, 50,000 homeless, the city of Tulare apparently only has 110 homeless. You know, we have two people a day, we can fix that in a year or a week, right? So, but it's still an issue because a lot of people don't want help.
That's where I was going to go.
And so, you know, a lot of people with mental health issues. Unfortunately, we just had a high-profile shooting in our city the other day. You know, it was a shooting that was caught on tape. Obviously, at the time, the officers who were struggling with the individual did not know that person had mental health issues. But that's a big issue in our city, in our county as well, throughout the district. So there's a lot to tackle. I feel strongly about the experience that I bring to the table to work on tackling those issues. But for me, it's always been about working together with communities, bringing communities together, having you guys meet with the folks from Dinuba and folks from other parts, from Inyo, for Bishop, and working together as a collective. Because I don't see that. I don't see the people. You guys are all in your area, which is important locally. But if you guys were to work together, and that's one of the things that I like to do as an assembly member, is put together some advisory committees and, again, use the technology that we hopefully will have available to communicate with each other so that we know what's going on.
What you mentioned about your entire district, where each individual area is kind of isolated, that's kind of the same thing we have here in this valley. We are not an incorporated area. We have no central government to advocate for us.
Right.
And we have the farming country out on the southeast side. We have Isabella, which is more commercial and more poor. We have Auburn Heights, which is a bedroom community. We have Kernville, which is tourism. And they have not in the past been able to come together and work together for a common goal.
Right.
And the fact that we don't have a central government to carry our concerns to the higher-ups has been a real handicap for us.
Well, I'll tell you this. When I come, you know, strongly from neighborhood empowerment. In Los Angeles, years ago, when Richard Reardon was the mayor way back when, there was an effort for the San Fernando Valley to break away from Los Angeles.
I remember that.
They wanted to create their own city, right? And so they went through the courts, and all of a sudden the judge said, hey, well, everybody has a way in. So people from Watts, people from San Pedro, people from Venice, everybody should weigh in whether you should separate yourself from LA. And obviously everyone said, hey, we're in the hole. You're going to be in the hole with us, all right? So anyway, so there was no San Fernando, right? There was no city of San Fernando. But as a result, Councilman Joel Wax and Richard Reardon, a couple others put together what they call these neighborhood councils. And so they created, there's 94 neighborhood councils in Los Angeles, which mirror the neighborhoods. Van Nuys, Boyle Heights, San Pedro, Silver Lake, you know, Winnetka, whatever the neighborhoods are in LA. And so I was very fortunate in my neighborhood, in Echo Park, to have been elected the president there for 6 years. And we represented an area that was 75,000 residents. Our district included Dodger Stadium, Angelino Heights, historic Filipino town, Echo Park. And what we did is we worked to bring neighborhoods together. And so that's something that I've always supported in empowerment. The other thing, when I worked in the legislature, I worked for a young assembly member back in 1998 who represented Linwood, Maywood, Bell Gardens, Southgate, that part of Los Angeles. And when he got elected, we worked very hard to create these district advisory committees. We created an advisory committee on environmental justice. We created committee on business, a lot of different things. And that's something that if I'm in a legislature, would want to model in areas like this, where we, even if it's facilitated through my office, these advisory committees, that would be a place where people would come together, come up with these ideas and plans and these solutions, and then work through my office to work with the Board of Supervisors, to work with other legislators, to try to make a difference.
as I'm listening to you, I can give you an example. Up here is our highway, fellow travelers on Highway 178, mm-hmm. the two-lane canyon portion. Yeah. We have a fellow coming from Caltrans in Fresno to our meetings. We work with the CHP, Kern, Council of Governments.
Yeah.
Who am I leaving out? So we formed that, and we now have 8 legal signed must-use signs in our canyon. We still have a lot of other things going on, but so it's a really good model for people working together, pushing things forward.
And if that model works, I mean, I just want to be able to enhance it, to do what I can as a representative to not reinvent the wheel, the wheel's working, but to enhance it, to make sure that there's resources available to do that. If there's a state office or something that needs to come down. So that's the kind of stuff that I really like to address.
And it's clear that all of those issues you have here, a bunch of people who would partner with you in trying to make all of that happen, but
we've got to get you elected, and your path to getting elected is not through this group. Your path to getting elected is through the what would it be,
57 or 53% Hispanics who are registered but don't vote.
Right.
And what are you?
Sure.
How hard are you working with the Hispanic communities to try to?
I'll answer that part of it, kind of the strategic part about it. So yeah, obviously we got to turn people out to vote. That's going to be a key. There is 3 Republicans and myself. So you know, one would say that they're going to split the vote. I mean, I just read an article the other day about this being an issue with Democrats and running for Congress. Well, it's on the flip side for me, because now you got 3 Republicans that are trying to buy, so they're going to split that vote. Out of the 172,000 registered voters, the estimated turnout will be 50,000. 50,000 votes.
Wow.
50 to 55. In the past, it's been 40 to 44. I'm going to add an extra 5,000-10,000 because it's a little more competitive. There's going to be a lot more folks running and this and that. So we're looking at 50 to 55,000 turnout. For me to get through this primary, I need about 20,000 votes. That's almost 40%, which is way more than I would need in a race. So how do I do that? So the strategy is going after those Democrats. You know, getting 85% of the Democrats to vote for me as a Democrat. The Latino vote as well, 85% of that vote. It's interesting, I ran in a district that had not a lot of Republicans, I did quite a good number of them, and my opponents were Republican, but I ended up getting more votes from Republicans than she did, because obviously it was a local race, and it was more nonpartisan, it was more about trying to take care of the neighborhood and all that. So, you know, my goal is if I can get 10% of the Republican vote, that's great, that's great. And then the decline of state, you know, a good chunk of that as well. So there's a whole strategy, and we put together a strategy that goes community by community. You know, you have a bigger assembly district, but I know how many votes I need in Dinuba. I know how many votes I need in Inyo County. There are 10,000 voters in Inyo County. 3,000 Democrats, 4,000 Republicans in the balance of the state. So the expected turnout in Inyo County is going